Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, Chairman. I have no potential conflict of interest. What I would like to talk to you in the over the next 20-25 minutes is how to manage hypothyroidism in pregnancy and give you an example of how we manage things in Birmingham. Hopefully that will stimulate some discussion, but I'm just giving it as an example of how we think this is a way to approach what remains quite a controversial area, really. So thyroid dysfunction in pregnancy affects between 2 and 4% of pregnancies, so it's relatively common. But in order to interpret what is abnormal in pregnancy, we first have to understand what is normal, and therefore we need to have an idea of what physiological changes occur to the thyroid function in pregnancy, and therefore how we define our normal reference ranges. Because the maternal fetal placental unit is really a very dynamic situation where you have very short time frames where things may change very transiently, but where crucial stages in development take place. I will then move over and give you, as I said, an example of how we manage overt hypothyroidism in Birmingham, and then move on to what remains still a very controversial area, which is subclinical, the management of subclinical hypothyroidism and isolated hypothyroxemia in pregnancy, and whether we should treat. And indeed, experts and guidelines from international societies do not necessarily agree. Finally, I will then spend a few minutes on how to manage, or whether we should manage, women who are euthyroid but who are TPO antibody positive in pregnancy, and highlight a trial that's currently ongoing in Birmingham and in the UK. So if we move first to the physiological changes to thyroid function in pregnancy, so what this figure here illustrates is a summary of some of the changes that take place. So as pregnancy, during the first trimester of pregnancy, HCG levels will be rising, and as a consequence of HCG, which has a mild thyrotrophic action, you will get a stimulation of the thyroid gland with increased T3 and T4 production. A further consequence of a HCG rise is that you get stimulation of estrogen and increased production of thyroxine-binding globulin in the liver, and therefore you get increased T3 and T4 binding. And as a consequence of that, you will get increased maternal total T3 and T4, and subsequently a decrease in pituitary TSH. A further aspect to consider is that the placenta is very rich in deiodinase 3, which will metabolize maternal thyroid hormones. But despite this, the fetus still has to have sufficient thyroid hormone supply to them, because during the first 20 weeks of pregnancy, the fetus is entirely reliant upon the mother's thyroid hormone production for normal development. So therefore, I don't think there's any doubt that there's an increased iodine and thyroid demand in pregnancy. So how does this impact? How does the maternal thyroid status impact on the fetal placental unit? Well, the two major areas that will be addressed during this symposium will be how this affects placental development and subsequently pregnancy outcomes. And also, as I've already said, there needs to be sufficient transplacental passage of thyroid hormones to the fetus, and this affects neurodevelopment in the fetus. I will not spend a lot of time on that because John Lazarus will be presenting that next. So these are elegant studies, which so we've known for quite some years. Now you can see these studies were performed in the 90s, but for quite some years we have known that indeed with a peak rise in HCG, which usually peaks around 10 weeks of pregnancy, you actually get a dip in serum TSH. And during the subsequent or the remainder of pregnancy, serum TSH will then rise slowly back into the normal pre-pregnancy range. So it's important that we take this lowering of serum TSH, especially in the first trimester, into account when we interpret thyroid function tests. So what this figure here illustrates are TSH concentrations in pregnancy measured, in, as you can see, quite a large number of singleton pregnancies as well as in twin pregnancies. And what they did in this study was take a multiple of medians to calculate a more specific reference range. And you can see that a significant proportion, about 28% of pregnancies, if we were to use standardly accepted non-pregnant reference ranges, would actually not have reached that threshold of being hypothyroid, whereas when we use this adjusted method, their serum TSH was actually high. And this is more pronounced in twin pregnancies because HCG levels are higher in twin pregnancies. This is a slide from a very elegant review in Nature Reviews, where 8 studies using different assays on different populations were studied. And these green rectangles here show the medians. And what is quite nicely illustrated here is how using these 8 different assays, how there is quite a wide variation in the 97.5th centile as well as in the 2.5th centile. But most of the variation appears to be at the upper end of the reference range. And again, you can see that serum TSH is indeed the median. Serum TSH is lowest in the first trimester, and then it rises. But this is significantly lower than what would be the upper limit of most reference ranges, which would be around 4 or 4.5 millionits per liter. So importantly, this was done in women who do not have a predisposition to thyroid autoimmunity, they were TPO anti-negative, and iodine-sufficient populations. So generally, free T4 decreases slightly throughout gestations, and what's illustrated on this slide here are results using various assays. So you can see that there is quite a marked, if you look at the absolute values, there is quite a marked variation in the absolute values of the serum free T4, but the general trend of the various assays is that serum free T4 decreases during gestation slightly. This is important, especially when you look at the third trimester, and this is a slide courtesy of Carol Spencer in the US, where you can see for all the various assays here, how serum free T4 concentrations in the third trimester of pregnancy really are at the bottom of the reference range. And indeed, there are significant proportions of patients that are actually below this reference range. And for the 2 most commonly used assays in the United Kingdom, this is highlighted here, how definitely in the third trimester, serum free T4 concentrations can be quite low. A further complication of measuring free T4 is that most of these assays involve immunomediated assays, and these are greatly affected by the changes in the serum protein milieu that I've already discussed, the rises in albumin and thyroxine-binding globulin. And therefore, when we look at studies, there are larger inter-assay variations when looking at free T4 assays when compared to TSH assays. Moreover, the extent of these changes is affected both by the individual as well by the assay. And the American Thyroid Association guidelines from 2011 recommend that ideally serum free T4 should be measured by extraction liquid chromatography, which of course is not available, readily available in most centers and certainly is not available in the center where I work. So when we decide on reference ranges, like we usually do, these should be based on the 25th and 97th percentile of that respective population. Ideally, the population should have an optimal iodine intake because, again, iodine will greatly affect thyroid function and what the reference range will be. And women should be free from major factors inhibiting thyroid function, including being TPO antibody positive or taking thyroid-related drugs. And so when you look at international guidelines, wide ranges indeed are reported. The one study where I showed you how serum TSH was significantly below the cutoff of 4 used a method called multiple of medians, which is a way of standardizing thyroid function tests, and I will come back to that on my next slide. But I think what guidelines highlight is that it is important that wherever possible, we use population-based pregnancy-specific reference ranges when interpreting thyroid function tests in pregnancy. However, this may not be available, I know it's not available in many centers, and therefore guidelines give sort of rather blunt cutoffs of what a serum TSH reference ranges should be, and they are listed there. So these are the reference ranges that are listed in the various guidelines here. For what would be acceptable if you do not have access to trimester-specific and population-specific reference ranges. So just briefly coming back to this use of multiple of medians, this is a very elegant paper from Robin Peters' group, where indeed they calculated for the various studies this multiple of median where you where you divide the individual value by the median population value, and you can see that when you do that, actually reference ranges become much more tight. So again, this is a way of adjusting values that you get using non-trimester-specific reference ranges. So I hope I've now highlighted what the pitfalls are in interpreting thyroid function tests, but assuming that we are indeed looking at what are relevant reference ranges, what I've listed here are the thyroid function abnormalities and the frequency of this occurring during various pregnancies. I have highlighted what I've been asked to talk about this afternoon. So overt hypothyroidism, where TSH is high and free T4 is low, occurs in about 0.5% of pregnancies. And of course, a number of women will only have partially treated overt hypothyroidism. A number will indeed be adequately treated. So overall, it affects about 1.5% of pregnancies. Then we have subclinical hypothyroidism, where TSH is high, but free T4 is normal. And we have isolated hypothyroxemia, where TSH is normal and free T4 is low. And I will discuss all these various conditions sequentially. So this is a slide courtesy of Susan Mandel, looking at pregnancy complications if overt hypothyroidism is untreated. And you can see the whole list of pregnancy complications here. Important complications, miscarriage, stillbirth, preterm birth, all have a significant incidence if overt hypothyroidism is untreated. And the odds ratios versus euthyroid women is again illustrated there, indicating that if we don't treat overt hypothyroidism in pregnancy, indeed there are significant effects on pregnancy outcomes. So does treatment with levothyroxine then reverse this? What is the effectiveness of treating women with overt hypothyroidism in pregnancy? It's important to note that there are no prospective intervention studies. So these data that I'm showing you here, these findings are based on retrospective studies. But when we look at a pooled odds ratio looking at three studies, these showed that inadequate treatment at the start of pregnancy, so inadequate levothyroxine replacement, where serum TSH was greater than 404.5, results in a significantly increased risk in miscarriage and pregnancy loss. A number of studies show actually no difference when treatment is adequate compared with euthyroid women, although there are indeed a number of studies that are listed here where even with adequate treatment of hypothyroidism, there is a residual increased risk of both cesarean delivery and late onset preeclampsia. It's important to remember that when looking at these studies, we don't really know whether all women were actually adequately treated, nor what the timing of levothyroxine replacement was. And I think what many experts agree on is that the sooner we correct hypothyroidism in pregnancy, the lower the risk of pregnancy complications. Just a brief word about neurodevelopment. Like I said, I'm not going to dwell on that, but there are, again, overt hypothyroidism is inadequately treated in early pregnancy. Actually, what the studies show is that childhood neurodevelopment is similar to controls, and there are two studies here to confirm that. And this table is taken from the Beruse study, showing that total IQ, performance IQ, and verbal IQ were actually similar in adequately and inadequately treated women. And a further study showing even normal or advanced neurodevelopment, although it has to be noted that this was a underpowered study, and therefore it may not be appropriate to take adequate conclusions from that. I promise you I would tell you what we do in Birmingham when we manage women on levothyroxine. So we use a five-step approach, and the main aim is that we prevent abnormal thyroid function. It is not a reactive approach, it's a preventative approach, and we try to mimic normal physiological changes during pregnancy. The first step is that we aim for adequate preconception replacement and that we therefore aim to keep the serum TSH below 2.5 before conception. We recommend empirical dose increases in early pregnancy. We recommend regular monitoring, that means 4 weekly monitoring at least during the first 20 weeks. And we use a predictive approach. So we change the dose when the serum TSH approaches the upper end of the normal range, normal pregnancy-specific range, and we do indeed use pregnancy-specific ranges in the hospital where I work, and our aim is to keep the serum TSH below 2. Postnatally, we recommend that the lady stays on levothyroxine, on the increased dose of levothyroxine, for 2 weeks, and that she then reduces back to the pre-pregnancy dose. So taking these various steps in turn then, so when we look at preconception levothyroxine replacement, so this was a study of 48 women who had pre-pregnant serum TSH below 5, which indeed is below the upper limit of normal for a number of assays. And in fact, quite a few women actually had a serum TSH that was below 2.5, 90% of them did. And when they looked at what happened to serum TSH at a median age of 5.5 weeks, you can see that there was a significant proportion of women, 30% of them, did indeed have a serum TSH that was greater than 5, that would be above the upper limit of even a non-pregnancy specific reference range. Some people go even further. If we keep the serum TSH below what we recommend and what a number of guidelines recommend, keeping the serum TSH below 2.5, this Argentinian study showed that if the preconception TSH is less than 1.2, there's only 17.2% of women who require a dose increase, whereas this increases to 50% when serum TSH is higher. So I therefore like to propose that good preconception TSH offers some protection from early hypothyroidism in pregnancy. So when should we increase? And I think a number of studies, like the one illustrated here, show that indeed the majority of women do require a dose increase in pregnancy, and that is not surprising based on the physiological changes that I discussed earlier. But when do we increase? So this is a relatively small study, but nicely illustrates when the peak week of first dose increases, and actually this peaks around 5 to 6 weeks. So these were women who were hypothyroid, either because they had autoimmune thyroid disease or because they'd had a thyroidectomy, and then women who were where the serum TSH was kept lower because they'd had thyroid cancer. But you can see that for most of the women, indeed, the peak week where the dose increase was needed is around 5 weeks. How much do we increase it by? Well, I think a number of studies agree that in general, women need about 25 to 50% increase in a pre-pregnancy dose. And we actually adopt a very pragmatic approach for this, an approach that adopts self-implementation, that is simple, effective, and safe. So we tell women to double their dose on 2 days of the week as soon as they have a positive urine pregnancy test. And by doing that, regardless of the dose that you're on, you get an approximate 29% increase in levothyroxine, which is indeed what many women need. If that's too complicated, we can ask women to increase by 25 micrograms if they're on a dose of 100 micrograms or less, and by 50 micrograms if they're on more than 100 micrograms daily. So we recommend monthly thyroid function testing up to 20 weeks, and also 4 weeks after we make a change to the dose. If you check it only every 6 weeks, which is what I would do in a non-pregnant person, we only detect 70% of abnormal, whereas by doing it 4 weekly, we detect about 92% of abnormal results. And we know that about 40 to 50% of women, despite this empirical dose increase, need a further adjustment. And again, that is illustrated by the same study that I've already spoken about. So patients were divided in a group where they were asked to double the dose on 2 days of the week or double it on 3 days of the week. And you can see that by doubling it on 2 days of the week, there is a higher proportion that needs a further increase. The danger of asking them to do it on 3 days of the week is that indeed a number of women have TSH suppression. We titrate by serum TSH. I've already illustrated that serum 3T4 measurements are much more liable to variation. And we basically keep our cutoff around here. Going back to this nice summary here of what the various assays give as the upper limit of normal. So certainly in the first trimester, we aim to keep the serum TSH below 2, and in subsequent trimesters below 2.5. So as I've said, these are preemptive dose changes rather than waiting for a serum TSH to become abnormal and then react. The therapy trial that I illustrated on a few of the slides has indicated that this can be safe, and indeed by monitoring regularly, even if we slightly over-replace, we will pick it up because we monitor a thyroid function test again after 4 weeks. And indeed, mild subclinical hypothyroidism is not thought to be harmful during pregnancy, but of course we would reduce the dose as appropriate. What we haven't got is a demonstration that this actually results in obstetric and neurodevelopmental benefits, and hopefully that will be something that can be shown in the next few years. Just a few words about obstetric management. This is obviously, I run a joint clinic with an obstetrician, and the obstetric management very much depends on the degree of control there is at the start of pregnancy. If patients are adequately treated, we treat them as low risk. If they're partially treated and serum TSH is high but free T4 is normal, then we consider giving increased surveillance for preeclampsia from 34 weeks onwards. If patients have overt hypothyroidism around time of conception, we put them on aspirin from 12 weeks onwards. They have 23-week uterine artery dopplers and increased screening for preeclampsia, as well as increased growth scanning. We do not induce for this reason, only if there are obstetric indications to do this. In the postpartum period, we know that levothyroxine is safe during pregnancy, so we ask them to revert to the pre-pregnancy dose 2 weeks postnatally, and that is because the increased levels of TBG will hang around for a few weeks after delivery. And we then, certainly in the UK, women are seen at 6 weeks postnatally for a check, and we then suggest that the GP rechecks their thyroid function. Moving on then to subclinical hypothyroidism and isolated hypothyroxinemia. What this slide here illustrates is the prevalences, and you can see that these vary quite highly according to the iodine status of the population, as well as on the way in which the assays are calculated. This is a meta-analysis that we performed as part of a review that we did, looking at 14 studies with, as you can see, a large number of people where there is a significant increased risk of pregnancy loss and preterm delivery before 37 weeks gestation, but not an increased risk of preeclampsia, which was shown by a few other meta-analyses. Looking then at isolated hypothyroxinemia, this can actually be a variant of normal and can be due to the problems I discussed with measuring free T4 in pregnancy, but can also be a consequence of iodine deficiency. And the only adverse outcome we found here was a placental abruption, with findings just missing significance for fetal macrosomia. Is free T4 replacement effective in managing subclinical hypothyroidism in pregnancy? So these are summary data from studies looking at IVF-treated women as well as unselected pregnancies. And you can see that overall, there is indeed a significant reduction in miscarriages if we give women with subclinical hypothyroidism levothyroxine replacement. Similarly, when we again look at the non-IVF treated cohort, there was a significant reduction, as is shown here, and by these numbers here, that there's a significant reduction in the preterm birth before 37 weeks. We have to be careful, though. These studies that I list here contain relatively few patients, and these are not results from randomized controlled trials. These are from retrospective and cohort studies. I won't dwell on the, because I'll be running out of time, but I won't dwell on the CAT study, which John Lazarus will talk about. But so these are the trials with regards to levothyroxine replacement in pregnancy, and results are awaited from this large trial here where neurodevelopment is being determined at 5 weeks. So again, the CAT study showed that there was no effect really from levothyroxine replacement in subclinical hypothyroidism or isolated hypothyroxinemia on a number of pregnancy outcomes. Screening remains controversial, and a number of guidelines recommend targeted screening in specific people who might be at risk of having thyroid dysfunction, and a few more controversial indications. And again, an obstetric history may lead us to want to screen certain women, but universal screening is not recommended. What do guidelines recommend? as you can see, most guidelines recommend treatment of subclinical hypothyroidism. The ATA guidelines specify that they would only do this in TPO antibody positive women, and they do not recommend for or against in TPO antibody negative women. Importantly, the American Congress of Obstetrics and Obstetricians and Gynecologists do recommend against levothyroxine replacement. With regards to isolated hypothyroxinemia, it's only the European Thyroid Association that recommends for, and the American Thyroid Association recommend against, with a number of other associations not coming off the fence. Just a few words about anti-TPO antibody positivity. So this is a nice meta-analysis from the BMJ, looking at women who are euthyroid but TPO antibody positive from a number of studies, where you can see that indeed a positive association with miscarriage was found in women who are TPO antibody positive, with an odds ratio of 3.9 in cohort studies and 1.8 in case control studies. Similarly, there was an association between TPO antibody positivity and preterm birth. Again, significant increased odds ratio there. And small numbers, less than 200 patients, but if you give levothyroxine replacement in euthyroid TPO antibody positive women, there is indeed a positive effect on reducing miscarriage. And in order to illustrate that further, the tablet trial is currently ongoing in the United Kingdom, where women are screened preconception. Those that are euthyroid and TPO antibody positive are randomized to receive either thyroxine or placebo, and our outcome is live birth at 34 weeks. We will be finishing recruitment at the end of this year. So I'll just list my conclusions there. I'm there because I'm running out of time a little bit, but I hope I've convinced you that we do need gestation and population-specific reference ranges because of the physiological changes in pregnancy. If we give levothyroxine replacement in overt hypothyroidism, we can prevent obstetric and neurodevelopmental consequences, and I propose a structured approach to this. Guidelines recommend treatment of subclinical hypothyroidism, although there is no RCT evidence for this. Management of isolated hypothyroxinemia remains conflicting, and we are awaiting exciting results on how to manage TPO antipositive euthyroid women. And I believe that we do need a lot of further study to define how we select women that require treatment during pregnancy. Thank you very much.